Praise the Lord. Greetings, everyone. Praying everyone is well. Dear beloved in Christ, it's always a joy to be in the house of the Lord. Amen. As we gather this morning in the presence of Almighty God and the whole company of the heaven and angels, let us lift our hearts in worship, praise, and thanksgiving. We come together not only to celebrate God's love, but to also reflect on His grace and mercy. Let me read a verse from Psalms 100. Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come into His presence with singing. Know that the Lord, He is God. It is He who made us, and we are His. We are His people and the sheep of His pasture. Enter His gates with thanksgiving and His courts with praise. Give thanks to Him. Bless His name. For the Lord is good. His steadfast love endures forever, and His faithfulness to all generations. Amen. Father God, as we come before You today with grateful hearts, as we enter this time of worship, we ask You for Your help in focusing our minds and hearts solely on You. We know this, that our thoughts can easily wander to the worries of the weak and concerns for others. But we pray that Your Spirit will guide us to set these aside and center ourselves on Your glory. Father, we thank You for this opportunity to worship as a family of faith. May Your presence fill this place and inspire us to live Your love in all we do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. The Lord be with you. Together, Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of Your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love You and worthily magnify Your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen. And there's a summary of the Lord. Our Lord Jesus Christ said, the first commandment is this, the Lord our God is the only Lord. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. The second is this, love your neighbor as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than this. Together, amen. Let have mercy upon us and write all these laws in our heart. We may now kneel or sit as we take this time to confess, check all our hearts and confess our sin. For God so loved the world that He gave His only Son, Jesus Christ, to save us from our sins, to be our advocate in heaven and to bring us to eternal life. Let us confess our sins in penitence and faith, firmly resolved to keep God's commandment and to live in love and peace with all men. Together, Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against You and against our fellow men in thought and word and deed. Through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault, we are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of Your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past and grant that we may serve You in newness of life to the glory of Your name. Amen.
Receive God's grace and His forgiveness. So may Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
As God's forgiven people, let us arise and say the Gloria Excelsis together. Together, glory to God in the highest, and peace to His people on earth. Lord God, Heavenly King, Almighty God and Father, we worship You, we give You thanks, we praise You for Your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, You take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer, for you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God, the Father. Amen. Brothers and sisters, at this time, Brother Joe and his team will lead us together in today's praise and adoration. Let us bring our praise to the Lord.
Good morning, church. Let's rise and give praise to God. Hallelujah. From the rising of the sun to the sun goes down, let the name of the Lord be praised. From the rising of the sun to the sun goes down, let the name of the Lord be praised. Gather to worship, becoming a choir to sing your praise, lifting our voices, joining our hearts in this house today, people of God. Power of God, for the kingdom of God, we sing. From the rising of the sun to the sun goes down, let the name of the Lord be praised. From the rising of the sun to the sun goes down, let the name of the Lord be praised. From the sky to the depth, from the east to the west, we give you praise.
Praise you when I'm laughing, praise you when I'm grieving, praise
praise you in every season of this soul. If we could see how much you're worth, your power, your might, your endless love, then surely we would never see. Everything that has breath, praise the Lord. And everything that, and everything that, and everything that has breath, praise the Lord. We praise you in heavens. Praise you in heavens, joining with the angels. Praise you forever and a day. Praise you on the earth now, joined with creation, calling all nations to your praise. If we could see how much you're worth, your power, your might, your endless love, and surely we would never cease to praise you. And everything that, and everything that, and everything that has breath, praise the Lord. And everything that, and everything that, and everything that has breath, praise the Lord. And everything that, and everything that, and everything that has breath, praise the Lord. And everything that, and everything that, and everything that has breath, praise the Lord. And I will worship, and I will worship, and I will worship you with every breath. And I will worship, and I will worship, and I will worship you with every breath. Father, Lord, we give you praise, Lord, with our breath, Lord. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. John 14:6 says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Hallelujah, Lord. Jesus, you alone are high and lifted up. You are exalted and magnified. Worthy, Lord, of all our praise, worship, and adoration. So, Lord, you truly deserve all glory and honor. You alone, Lord. You alone. Rise the Lord, be like glory, though I could pride myself in battles won. I've been blessed beyond measure, and by His strength alone I overcome. Oh, I could stop and count successes like diamonds in my hand, and those trophies could not equal to the by which I stand. In Christ alone I place my trust, and find my glory in the power of the cross. In every victory, let it be said of me, my source of strength, of hope, is Christ alone. Christ alone will I glory, for only by His grace I am redeemed. Only His tender mercy could reach beyond my weakness, my need. Now I seek no grace.
Alone I place my trust and find my glory in the power of the cross. In every victory, let it be said of me, my source of strength, my source of hope is Christ alone. Is Christ alone. Amen. As we remain standing, let us together read the collect on the 14th Sunday after Trinity. Almighty Father, whose will is to restore all things, in your beloved Son, the King of all, govern the hearts and minds of those in authority and bring the families of the nations, divided and torn apart by the ravages of sin, to be subject to his just and gentle rule, who is alive and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Let us be seated right now as the first reading is brought by Brother Abraham.
First reading is taken from Ephesians chapter 5, verses 22 to 33. I repeat, the first reading is taken from Ephesians chapter 5, verses 22 to 33. Wives, submit to your own husbands as to the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife, even as Christ is the head of the church, his body, and is himself its Savior. Now, as the church submits to Christ, so also wives should submit in everything to their husbands. Husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her, that he might sanctify her, having cleansed her by the washing of the water of the word, so that he might present the church to himself in splendor, without spot or wrinkle or any such thing, that she might be holy and without blemish. In this same way, husbands should love their wives as their own body. He who loves his wife loves himself. For Noah ever hated his own flesh, but nourishes and cherishes it, just as Christ does the church, because we are members of his body. Therefore, a man shall leave his father and mother and hold fast to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. This mystery is profound, and I am saying that this refers to Christ and the church. However, let each one of you love his wife as himself, and let the wife see that she respects her husband. This is the word of the Lord. Amen.
Will you please stand for the reading of the Gospel? The Gospel according to John, chapter 17, and beginning at verse 1. Glory to Christ our Savior. John chapter 17, verses 1 to 11. When Jesus had spoken these words, he lifted up his eyes to heaven and said, Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son, that the Son may glorify you, since you have given him authority over all flesh to give eternal life to all whom you have given him. And this is eternal life, that they know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. I glorified you on earth, having accomplished the work that you gave me to do. And now, Father, glorify me in your own presence with the glory that I had with you before the world existed. I have manifested your name to the people whom you gave me out of the world. Yours they were, and you gave them to me, and they have kept your word. Now they know that everything that you have given me is from you, for I have given them the words that you gave me, and they have received them and have come to know in truth that I came from you, and they have believed that you sent me. I am praying for them. I am not praying for the world, but for those whom you have given me, for they are yours. All mine are yours, and yours are mine, and I am glorified in them. And I am no longer in the world, but they are in the world, and I am coming to you, Holy Father. Keep them in your name, which you have given me, that they may be one, even as we are one. This is the gospel of Christ. Praise to Christ our Lord. Would you please be seated? So we have been covering the book of Ephesians, and one of the hinge points has been chapter 4, verse 1, where it says, I therefore, a prisoner of the Lord, urge you to walk in a manner worthy of the calling to which you have been called. So all the sermons after that verse has this emphasis, how we are to walk in a life worthy of the calling, worthy of the gospel. Yeah, and so we'll be looking at unity, we'll be looking at purity, and today we're looking at the relationship within the household. If we are to grow as one spiritual family, we need to grow in our nuclear families. And so today, the focus on husband and wife, and I'm glad to have Pastor Leon to open God's Word to us.
Good morning, church. Well, I thought that was God striking me with lightning. Yeah. Well, that was a shock. Come, give me a minute. I'll just let me set up everything. Yeah. Okay, let's go to God in prayer. Yeah. Dearest Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for your word that is about to be declared. And Father, we pray, Holy Spirit, help us to understand the message today. Help us, Lord, to look at your word and to take your word seriously, Lord, as you teach us this morning through your Spirit. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Yeah, so once again, good morning, church. Very tough topic. Husbands and wife. And I must say, I am not qualified. Why I'm not qualified? Because in marriage, we all know that it's hard work. Yes or no? Those who are married, you know it's hard work. Yeah? Okay? For those who are not married, take this as a marriage seminar. This morning's message. Alright? Now, but in all honesty and all seriousness, I cannot but help look at the scripture and preach from the word. And I do not want to add anything to the word. Because I don't want to stand before God one day and say, hey, how come that day you add that to my word? Huh? You know, so yeah. I just want to preach from the word, and I want to be very sensitive and also very encouraging. This message today is to help us look at a very interesting parallel that Paul brings out here, using marriage, you know. And so here, he presents in Ephesians 5, 22 to 33 is what the marriage relationship should look like, okay? And Paul reveals a very beautiful picture of marriage. These directions are commands to the husband, to the wife, to give themselves to each other. Now, when we make ourselves the center of attention in love and in marriage, what happens is we lose the vision of marriage that God has in place, and before we know it, we begin to actually destroy the relationship when we are inward-looking, when we are self-centered. We wreck, we destroy this very beautiful picture of a godly marriage when we seek our own desires instead of the desires of our own spouses. So we need to yield to one another, and that is the only way a marriage can be full of joy and pleasing to the Lord. So I'm going to cover three areas. Okay, the first area is the message to the wives. Okay, so please don't throw anything at me. Okay. Then the second portion I want to cover is about the husbands, the role. And then to end with the beautiful picture that God has given to each one of us. Now I say this again, that I am not qualified to say or to sort of speak on this topic, but I want to reveal to you what the Lord has shown me in this passage and also in according to my own marriage. Yeah, it's also, I'm also preaching to myself, okay? Yeah, so I'm also preaching to myself. So let's talk about the wives first from chapter 5, verses 22 to 24. He begins with the wives, okay? Paul, he's talking about, he's addressing the wives. He's asking the wives to walk worthy in the calling of, you know, so walking worthy of the calling in marriage means that wives will have to submit to husbands, okay? Hang on. I'm being very cautious here. The word says to submit, all right, to their husbands. Now, I do believe you would agree with me that today the word submission, or the word submission, has become such an ugly word, okay, in our society today. Because the word submission, right, a lot of people have this idea that submission is to be dominated, to be oppressed, to be subjugated, all right? No. That's not the meaning that Paul is bringing here. His idea behind this is basically, you know, it's to, he's speaking it straightforward. The submission here is not a kind of submission that is to be subjugated. It's more like yielding. So for us, like so let me just use the word yield, okay? It's to yield, is to help us to understand what submission looks like. Now, all the wives in this place here, I want you to just think and consider a few things about what is being told to all of you all here, okay? Or what is being shared by Paul through Scripture. Now, the greatest example of submission is Jesus. You know, and Jesus, you know, he's not asking us to do something that he himself did not do, right? Jesus submitted to the will of the Father. We all know that. He yielded to the interest of the Father when the Father was going to ask him to be the sacrificial lamb for all of humanity. So he himself yielded. So wives, we are supposed to choose to voluntarily comply or to submit to leadership of our husbands, okay? Now, it is important to note that something, there is something very, very interesting. And this is not for the husbands. So Paul, at this section, is not talking to the husbands. He's talking to the wives, okay? Now, the scriptures do not teach you, wives, that to yield or there will be consequences. That means, if you don't listen to me, I'm going to punish you. No. Okay? There is no punishment here. It's voluntary submission. You as a wife, you're supposed to submit or yield voluntarily. It's not the husband's forceful subjugating of you. If that happens, that's a red flag. You should not be forced. You should just submit, yield to your husband. Now, I believe, I dare to say this, that this has been misunderstood far too often. A lot of marriages, there have been issues on this. I know why, because I have certain friends whose marriages have broken down because the husbands are very forceful upon the wives. And then I end up talking to my friend, I say, you want me to slap you? You're not supposed to force your wife to do anything, you know. And nowadays, husbands, you can be taken to task, criminal law against you, if you try to do anything funny. Okay, just to let you know, okay? So here, it is misunderstood. Now, if the wife, on the other hand, doesn't yield, doesn't give in, there is nothing husbands you can do. You can't force her. You can't choke her. You can't chicken wing her like that. You know, you can't do all of that. It's really up to her to subjugate, to submit to you. So you can't force her. Because after all, guess what? Wives, you are accountable to God. The day will come you stand before the great throne. He's going to talk to you. He's going to ask you questions. So you are accountable. And when you volunteer to yield to the husband's leadership, that is the way what Christ wants you to do. Not to be forced into submission. That's not the right way. So, it should be your desire to submit to the will of your husband. If you do not desire to follow his leadership, then you should not marry this man at all. Right? You should not be in marriage with him. This is why I always tell the young people, marriage decision, very, very, very important and must not be entered into lightly. It's serious business. The woman is willing, she must remember, right? You are willing to put yourself in a vulnerable position of yielding to your husband in the leadership and relationship of the marriage. So you need to consider that submission or yielding does not mean that you are an inferior person or you are the inferior partner of the marriage. Question: was Jesus Christ inferior when he submitted to God the Father? No, he was not. He was not. He never is inferior. He yielded. And when you yield to your husband as a wife, you are showing strength and godly meekness. Submission should be praised and not looked down upon. Okay? And notice in verse 22 of that passage, you will see that Paul says, wives, submit to your own husband as to the Lord. It is worship. It is worship to the Lord. This is your service to the Lord. You are serving Christ when you yield yourself to your husband. Okay? And note, in verse 23, it gives the reason why wives are to yield. The husband is the head of the wife. God created the relationship where there is one head. By God's design, the husband and wife are one flesh, so as to function together under one head. We need to remember this, that in a marriage, the two individuals, husband and wife, they do not operate autonomously. They don't. Okay? They live together, they work together, they function together, they plan together, they come to agreement together. In fact, you know, what is very interesting is God is setting up through this picture of marriage a beautiful parallel to the church and Christ. And I'll share with you later. So the marriage relationship is to be as beautiful as Christ and the church. Wives are to lovingly desire to listen and follow the leadership of your husband. Now verse 24 makes it even clearer. So also wives should submit. It says here, now as the church submits to Christ, so also wives should submit in everything to their husbands. Now this is the part where it gets a bit tricky. Bear with me. It does not matter if you do not like how your husband leads. There will be moments like that. It does not matter if you are unhappy with his decisions. There are moments like that. But you need to remember the words written here. We are to submit. Wives are to submit. And yes, we are all not perfect human beings. We are not. We have our flaws. So basically, Paul is saying there's no exceptions here to submission. We cannot be full of excuses and not want to yield our will to our husband's leadership. Maybe you say, yeah, he doesn't love me the way I want him to love me, you know? Or maybe he does this, lah, he does that, you start to nitpick him, okay? Or you judge him all the time for every single thing that he does. Now, his negative actions, right, it does not give you the right to unyield from him. Okay? And by the way, you picked him, by the way, as a husband. For those who are married, you picked him. If you think he is so terrible, then it reflects on you because you are the one that married him. You picked him. Okay, you chose him. And husbands, you also, you picked your wife. Okay, you picked your wife. You courted her, she courted you, and then you came together, right? I mean, it's not like you dial a bride or something, then someone delivers your wife to your front door, right? It doesn't happen that way. Okay, my case was different. Yeah, my case was very different. People ask me, how did I meet my wife? I said, I met her at my mom's front door. And they, huh? What, bride delivery? I said, no. Literally, I'm not joking. My wife actually came to my front door of my mother's home when I was visiting my mother having dinner. No, she was not selling anything. It was a friend of a friend who brought her over. And when she came to the door, it was like, whoa, man. That's how we got woman. That's how we got the word woman. Yeah, okay. Anyway, moving along. In marriage, there's a covenant, all right? And we need to choose wisely, okay? For those who of y'all who are planning to get married in the near future, it's a vow that has to be taken very secretly, all right? Now this, well, easy. Jennifer Lopez, have you heard? She's now the modern-day Elizabeth Taylor. 4 divorces already. God help her. Yeah, so we need to take marriage very, very important, very sacred. Now, the picture of Christ, all right, is not begrudging submission. He encourages the leadership. Do not undermine your husband's leadership. Some may ask, what if he will not lead? That means if my husband doesn't want to take the lead in the house. Then consider what Peter taught in 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 1 to 2. Likewise, wives, be subject to your own husbands, so that even if some do not obey the word, they may be won without a word by the conduct of their wives when they see your respectful and pure conduct. Husbands will sure be moved if they see your wife, the wife so loving still, and he's being a clod or he's being a clown, you know. But the wife, he will look at the wife and say, wow, why are you so different now, my dear? You know, I must be, and that's my story. You know, I share very briefly. I mean, I was a clown in marriage. I was like so terrible with my wife. I ill-treated her. Okay, I didn't touch her. I did not whack her. I say publicly, public confession, okay? I never mishandled my wife when I was not a Christian, but I was very, very brutal in the words I spoke to her. And so I was not wearing the pants in the house. She was wearing the pants in the house, and that's wrong. But I didn't understand. Only when we became Christians, we fully comprehend what Christ was showing us in marriage. Now that's a story for another day. So wives, you are obeying Christ when you yield to your husband, regardless of how difficult he makes it to do so. And God knows, God sees, all right? He knows your loving service to him, and you will be rewarded. You will be rewarded by the Lord for serving to the Lord by yielding to your husband. Amen? Yes, wives, you will be rewarded for your faithfulness to your husbands. Now, I address the husbands. Men, get ready for this. Walking worthy of your calling means that you will love your wives. Okay, you will love your wives. And you notice what this love looks like. Love does not simply mean having a warm feeling towards her. I love you, like, you know, the warm, cozy, wozy stuff, you know, all the lovey-dovey stuff. Husbands are to love as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her. It's more than the warmth and the coziness. Husbands, you are not told to rule over your wives. You are not told to rule over. Okay, the directions are very clear. Wives submit and husbands rule. Now the husbands, your ruling here, what does it look like? The ruling here is we need to look at Christ. Okay, Christ gave himself completely. He gave his everything. He gave up his interests, his desires, and the will for the church. All of us, husbands, you are to give up your interests and your desires for the interests and desires of your wives. Everything husbands do is to be for the benefit of their wives. Do I hear an amen? I don't hear an amen very convincingly. Husbands, you heard what I said. I'm talking to you, gentlemen, and those brothers here who are planning to get married. I am speaking from Scripture, okay? Scripture is teaching us here. I say again, Christ gave himself completely. He gave his everything. He gave up his interests, his desires, and the will for the church. Husbands, you are to do the same, to give up your interests and your desires for the interests and desires of your wife. You must do it for the benefit of your wives. Okay? Now, can we hear an amen? Much better. So this is exactly how Christ loves us. He did not do what was best for him. He did what was best for us. Male and female, the ones that he created. Christ desired to do this. Husbands desire to give to their wives. You must desire to give to your wives. Husbands, listen to their wives and lead so that her interests are always above. You know, that's the problem with us men. I can speak. This one I qualify. Always my wife comes to me. You know, darling, I got this problem. Oh, I try to find solution immediately. Try to give solution. Then she look at me. Did I ask you for a solution? No, but then I'm telling you. No, did I ask you for a solution? No. I just want to share what's on my heart. I want to rant. I want to vent. Wives, correct not? Correct not? Sometimes you want to do that, right? Yeah, I see some of the wives' heads nodding. Yeah, but we are very quick to want to give solutions. So we need to understand, we need to listen to them, and we need to put their interests above ours. Now, there are no loopholes. And what I mean is, you husbands are not allowed to stop loving her because she chooses maybe not to yield to you. Maybe she's struggling. And then you choose to stop loving her because she doesn't want to listen to you. You are not to stop loving her no matter what. No matter what, you are not supposed to stop loving her. There are no exceptions. There are no excuses. Now, I shared not too long ago about my wife having a medical condition about her jaw. And I thank many of y'all who've been praying for her. And yeah, you're probably thinking why she's not here today, why she's not here with me. Because maybe she wants to avoid being here as I share, right? No, I've actually asked her to go on a short break, a short trip overseas with some of her good friends to rest. And so anyway, you know, it's very, very challenging. And I do believe some of y'all know, when you have a very close loved one who has a medical condition, you need to be very patient. And we have to walk on eggshells around that person because they are so sensitive, because they're in pain. And you know, it's a real struggle. But I tell you, when I was rostered to do this passage, you know, of course I smiled and I was like, well, Vicar really gave me a number, man. You know, but it was very interesting because as I prepared for this message, God used this message to reassure me and to reaffirm my position as a husband in the marriage. And even though she's going through great pain and discomfort, I began to realize, wow, I can imagine how Christ is feeling for his church when he sees many of us suffering, you know, and you know, he wants us to be a spotless bride for him, right? But yet many of us, we are suffering within the church. And so, yeah, I just wanted to encourage all of us, you know, that every one of us in our marriages, in our relationships, we all have challenges. If anyone can get up right now and come and tell me, oh, my marriage is perfect, I'll look you straight in the eye and say, don't lie. Don't tell a lie. Because every marriage, there are challenges. Every single one of them. And many of you all are nodding your heads. And I know that you agree with me in that. So we must remember, husbands, you need to continue to love your wife even though she's nagging, even though she is in such pain, even though she's just out of sorts. You know, for us men, our brain, we got compartments. We have compartments we can switch off, like a remote control, can turn on, can turn off. Through my 31 years of being married to my wife, I noticed my wife has no compartments. She's multi-wired, can do multiple things at one time. For me, I cannot. Yeah, I see some husbands smiling. Yeah. And we are wired so differently. We are wired to complement each other. We are wired to build and encourage each other. That's the beauty of the marriage. And so I remind the husbands again. Remember, you picked your wife. You picked Joyce, Pastor Stephen. Okay? You picked your wife. Okay? And guess what? You made a vow on the marriage day. And that vow is to her. Your vow, you told God to love her, to cherish her. Through sickness, through good times, health, poor, you know the drill. So Christ, He has given us this love that we are to love. So husbands, we must continue to love your wives in all circumstances. And you know what? That's not the only thing. Husbands, you are also responsible for the welfare of the family. You have a great role in all areas of your family. Only when you are loving Christ and you pursue Christ can husbands lead their families properly. And remember, your family is not a corporation, it's not a company, so you're not the CEO, okay? You are not a CEO, okay? The more you pursue Christ, I give you a promise, you will want to love your family and your children dearly. Really. And that I can testify. Many, many men of God that I've met, they all share the same thing. There's a network in Singapore called the Men's Ministry Network. And I had the privilege to hear some of their testimonies before. And all of them said the minute they chose to put Christ first in their lives, they began to see their wife in a different light. They begin to see their children in a different light. If you haven't tried it, try it. Okay? And so here, we need to also remember that Paul, he gives us this very interesting imagery of asking the husbands to love themselves. Why love ourselves? Because if we don't love ourselves, then how can we love others? And more so for the wife. And none of us hate our bodies. If we hate our bodies, you need to seek help. We should be thankful of what God has given us. So he gives us this picture of loving ourselves so that we can love our wives. And Paul quotes in Genesis 2:24 in verse 31, he says, "She is your body. So the two of you are now one flesh. You do not lead her in a hateful or a trashy way. Because you love yourself, you need to love her too. So she is your very body. And your wife must be treated with great care and love." And so this is the big picture I want to share with you now. Verse 32 is an amazing declaration. A truly Christian marriage will mirror the relationship between Christ and the church. Paul gives us an example for us to look. How? Through our marriages. That's the visual that he gives us. So look to the relationship of Christ and the church. Everything in this part of the scripture, it uses the image of both wives and husbands so we know how to behave properly and walk worthy of our marriages. So I hope you will seriously consider husbands and wives, those out there right now, that you will consider today a reset. If your marriage has been a bit tough and challenging because maybe both are operating autonomously with your own ideas, may I encourage you today to look at a reset. God is waiting. God is waiting to help you. And then for those of you who are going to get married, wow, this is a great lesson today. If you are the man in that relationship, that's what you're supposed to do. If you are the lady in that relationship, then that's what you're supposed to do. It's here for us to help us in our marriages. So, verse 33 offers a great summary. Men, love your wives. It does not matter if she deserves it or not. We, in first place, do not deserve the love of Christ, yet Christ also loves us. Vice versa. Wives, the husband is tough guy, hard to break through, still love him. Don't give up. Don't give up. Husbands, you must give everything for her. Everything. Just as Jesus gave to all of us. Now, each other's needs and desires will be met by each other within the relationship. But when we make marriage about ourselves, if we look inwardly and just think about I, me, and myself, what are we going to get out of it? We're going to damage the relationship because we are inward looking. And then the whole beautiful picture of this marriage will be destroyed and sinfulness will come in and rule the marriage. So brothers and sisters, I encourage you now, walk worthy of the calling God has called you to. Christ, live for Christ by joyously desiring to love and yield to each other. So again, I'm not scolding you. I'm just encouraging you through scripture of how we need to take marriage seriously. Today, this world, marriage is very loose. I can come, I can go. It's like a revolving door. But in the Christendom, as believers of the Lord Jesus Christ, we need to make sure we do our very best in our marriages, even though there are challenges. Till death do us part. And you know what? I tell you what is the difference between a marriage that is under Christ and a marriage that is not Christian. When you have a marriage built on Christ as your rock, as your pillar, Christ is the glue to the foundation of your marriage. If you do not have Christ in your marriage, that's the challenge. That is the challenge. And so I pray for those of you all here whose spouses are not believers, do not give up. Pray for your spouse. If you are here already in church and your spouse knows that you're here, we praise God because your spouse has allowed you to come here and be in the midst of God's people. So I want to encourage you, those spouses here whose husbands or wives are not believers, do not give up. Do not give up. Pray. Pray, continue to pray, and I believe your prayer will be answered. Yes, your prayer will be answered. Because there are many testimonies out there of spouses coming to faith together. One first, and then maybe one later. So don't give up, okay? Don't give up. Keep praying. I'd like to invite the worship team to come up now. They've chosen a very beautiful song. It's called Jesus at the Center. And you know, there's also a very stark difference with the men on death row when I walk with. Those who do not have Christ and those who have Christ. Those who do not have Christ, when they walk to the gallows, they shake, they shiver, some of them even defecate. But the ones who have Christ, they hold their heads up high and they walk to the gallows and they turn around and they tell me, Pastor Leon, when I see Jesus, I'll send him your love and your regards. That's how strong their faith is. So Christ is the center of it all. Come, let me pray as the worship team prepares. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I just want to thank you for this message this morning. Lord, a tough message, but a real message. And so, Father, I pray now for all my brothers and sisters here, those who are married right now in this place. Father, I pray you continue to bless their marriage and guide them. And for those here whose other spouse is not a Christian, Father, we pray that you'll strengthen our brothers and sisters, that, Lord, they will continue to pray and cry out to you that their spouse will have an encounter with the living God. So, Father, we thank you once again for this message. I commit everybody into your hands now. Thank you, Lord, for your faithfulness and your grace and your mercy over our lives. In Jesus' name. Amen. Let's rise as we join the worship team.
Always be you.
center of it all. Jesus at the center of it all. From beginning to the end, He will always be, it's always been You, Jesus. Jesus, nothing else matters. Nothing in this world. Center of my life, from beginning to the end, it will always be, it's always been You, Jesus. Jesus, nothing else matters, nothing in this world. Heavens, Jesus be the center, it's all about You, yes it's all about You, from my heart to the heavens, Jesus be the center, it's all about You, yes it's all about You, from my heart to the heavens, Jesus be the center, it's all about You, yes it's all about You, from my heart to the heavens, Jesus be the center, it's all about You, yes it's all about You, from my heart to the heavens, Jesus be the center, it's all about You, yes it's all about You. Jesus be the center of Your church. Jesus be the center of Your church. Every knee will bow, and every tongue shall confess You, Jesus. 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 Oh, Jesus. Jesus. From my heart to the heavens. Yes, it's all about you. From my heart to the heavens, Jesus be the center. It's all about you. Yes, it's all about you. From my heart to the heavens, Jesus be the center. It's all about you. Yes, it's all about you.
It's all about you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Amen. Hallelujah. Jesus, it's all about you. From my heart to the heavens, Jesus be the center. It's all about you. Let us be seated at this time for the announcements. A very good morning once again, everyone. Good morning. Please look around with me and see how blessed are we with all these beautiful people around us. Do you see any new people around you? Anyone new today? If there's anyone new here today, you may raise your hands. We welcome you. If not, we will just say hello to one another. Right? Amen. There is somebody there. Right? Praise the Lord. And there's another brother there. Amen. Well, brother, I ask you to raise your hand. You stand up. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Please join us for our breakfast at the canteen at the back later. And this morning, even as we welcome one another, I want you all to keep that joy. And as we heard today's sermon, it's just a reminder. I know, and Pastor Leon just called me directly. It's just like, before he started here, and next minute he called me, he said, oh Lord, I have to go back home on my knees. I pray that every one of you all be filled to this message. The joy remains in your heart, you know. Right, okay, let us go into today's announcement. A quick one, we have our prayer and praise this September on the 6th. This will be this Friday. How many of you are free this Friday, 8 p.m.? If you are free, please come. Right, we need more people to come and pray with us. On 6th September, we'll be at Second Century. The next announcement will be confirmation. Okay? A confirmation course will be run by Pastor Leon. Okay, his contact number is up there. The confirmation classes will be on 28 September, October 5th, October 12th, and 26th October. It will be from 10 a.m. to 12 p.m. It will be held at the conference room. But before you attend the confirmation classes, please give your name to Pastor Leon so he will add you all in a chat group. All right. The next announcement, I'll invite Reverend Vicar to announce it.
Thanks. Thank you, Vicar. Thanks, Pastor Stevens. Yeah, over the past few weeks, we've been encouraging participation in the Angel Tree Project, a project where the call to serve has a bridge between the families and families who have someone in prison. Yeah, so we praise the Lord for the generous support over all the three congregations. So we have 40 volunteers who bless 18 families in November-December period. And we've exceeded the target for donations. Our target was 5,000. We have 6,000, one and above. Yeah, so we praise the Lord for the generous support. And also, we continue to pray for the volunteers as they prepare to serve as ambassadors for Christ. I also want to thank the coordinating team. All these projects requires the effort to coordinate, and it's all lay-driven. I think this is one of the pastor's joy, when you have projects that are driven by the lay people. And so we have a team led by Joyce, together with Arul and Rita. So can we just thank them for their efforts? And the next slide is to tell those who have volunteered, you will hear from Rita, who will be forming a WhatsApp group to communicate all further details of this. So look out for the WhatsApp message, okay? Yeah. Okay, with that, we'll have the intercession. June will come and to lead us in prayer. So I invite you to kneel if you are able as we join our hearts in prayer.
Let us quieten our hearts before the Lord. Let us pray for the whole church of God in Christ Jesus and for all men according to their needs. O Lord, bless the church throughout the world and all those who seek to do your will today. May their work bring hope to areas in the world living uncertainty and despair. We lift up to you our Archbishop, Reverend Titus Chung. O God, we pray that he will be guided by the Holy Spirit as he leads the Anglican community in the province of Southeast Asia. May thy presence also be with our vicar, Reverend Jeremy, Reverend Ezra, Reverend Chu, and all pastoral staff here at St. Paul's Church, as you guide them in the ministry here and in the surrounding community. We pray especially for your protection over our Archbishop and his family and the families of all our pastoral staff here in St. Paul's. O Lord, we thank you for the message, which is a reminder to us that your greatest commandment was to love you and love each other. Our relationship with you is reflected in marriage, which you have given us as a holy relationship. Help us to put aside our pride and humbly serve each other by following your example. We place into your hands all our cares and needs here, where each is part of the body of Christ to serve you with humility. Continue to sustain and develop our outreach efforts here in St. Paul's, in the Little Seeds Preschool, the Sunday School Genesis Kids, the Junior Youth Fellowship, the Helping Hand, the Angel Tree Project, the Nursing Home at Bangkok, the Migrant Community, and also the overseas mission at Pai in Thailand. Lord, the Cup of Faith Fellowship has reached its first anniversary. We pray that you will continue to bless our sister Angeline as she works tirelessly in the Cup of Faith in reaching out and engaging the seniors. Lord, in thy mercy, O God, you are righteous and holy, and we can be confident that you are in control on what is happening around the world. We pray for all the conflicts, crises, and wars which are escalating and are causing massive instability and suffering of civilians. We pray for the escalating war in Ukraine and the widening tensions in the Middle East. O Lord, we pray for all leaders to exercise maximum restraint, that they be tempered by your love, not power, and to negotiate in sincerity towards a ceasefire so that food and basic needs can reach the people in need. O Lord, we also lift up to you the world which is suffering from global heating, leading to more frequent and severe heat waves, droughts, wildfires, and increasingly destructive storms, deadly floods, and landslides. We pray that you grant the world leaders the political will to treat global heating with more urgency. Amid all this toil, we thank you for your divine protection, keeping Singapore safe. O Lord, we pray that our President Tharman, our Prime Minister Lawrence Wong, and his cabinet may be guided by your compassion, justice, and righteousness, especially in reaching out to the needy in our community. Lord, in thy mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for those who are in need of thy comfort and healing grace. Great is thy faithfulness to all who need you. We pray for Stella Correa, who is still recovering in the hospital from her fall. May you grant her full recovery and enable her to walk again. She's also experiencing breathlessness due to water retention in her lungs. We ask for your healing touch to ease her discomfort and restore her health. Grant her strength and comfort during this challenging time. Guide the medical team treating her, giving them wisdom and skill. We also lift up to you David Lowe, Linda Milner, Lynette Sia, Jonathan Kasim, Susan Chua, Willie and Elsie, Ellen and Hee Chai, and Mrs. Raman, asking for your strength and comfort to be upon them and their caregivers. May your arms surround them and fill them with your peace. Grant them a restored body, mind, and spirit as they continue to trust in your unfailing love. Lord, in thy mercy, hear our prayer. Grant these prayers, O merciful Father, for the sake of thy Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
We stand as we share the peace with one another. We are the body of Christ. In the one Spirit, we were all baptized into one body. Let us then pursue all that makes for peace and builds up our common life. The peace of the Lord be always with you. We share the peace with one another.